Welcome to Medcastplus. I am your host, Dr. Jack Braha. On the show, we feature local healthcare providers and physicians, except tonight, we have Wilhelmina Grant, who is a patient to come meet with us tonight. She is a cancer survivor, artist, author, veteran of TWA and the Friendly Skies, and now an artist in residence at the Cancer Center at Woodhull Hospital. Wilhelmina, it is an honor to have you here. It is so interesting to talk to you about everything you have done. We were talking out in the green room, and we should have just videotaped that and put that on TV, but let's try to organize everything for our viewers today. Welcome to Medcastplus. Tell us a bit about yourself.
Oh, it's great to be here. Thank you for inviting me. Well, I'm from Brooklyn originally, and I now live in Harlem. I'm an artist in residence at the Woodhull Medical Center through the Creative Center, which is an organization that places artists in residence in hospitals all throughout the city. And what I do as an artist in residence is I work in the cancer center, in the clinic, as well as the infusion suite, and I bring the patients an arts experience while they're waiting for the doctor and or while they're having their chemotherapy.
So patients in the hospital laying in a chair waiting for their chemotherapeutic infusion.
And while they're having it,
yes. While they're having it, I could imagine it's a stressful, harrowing, very anxious time for patients.
Absolutely.
And you bring artistry to the bedside.
And this helps beat the boredom. It takes their mind off of what they're going through. It's like a little vacation away from cancer.
What kind of projects do you do with these patients at the bedside?
Well, I determine what's possible for them to do. Some of them have to keep their arms stabilized, so they only have the use of one arm to do an arts project. So we may do something together, something involving fibers. We'll do a knitting project or a crochet project, something soft, something easy to manipulate, or some drawing or some painting, and the sky's the limit. They usually get very interested, and they find a way to do the project if they're interested enough, they find a way.
So even in this tough time in their lives and getting these chemicals through their veins and going through the side effects, they find interest in doing these art projects.
Well, the key thing about it, besides taking the anxiety down, it's impossible, you're a doctor, you know this, it's impossible for the body to experience pain and pleasure at the same time. So we replace that other feeling with something pleasurable. So it's very pleasurable to be creative and to do something artistic and to experience something new.
So it's therapeutic for the patients,
absolutely.
Bringing them some pleasure or some distraction,
absolutely.
As well from the infusion or the cancer care they're receiving. Are all patients receptive, or do you get some people who don't want to participate?
Sometimes it takes a moment. There was one woman that I would ask every single week for 6 months, would you like to try something? I've got this or I have that. And she said, no, thank you. And then one day I didn't ask. And she said, aren't you going to ask me if I want to participate?
That was the day, huh?
Would you like to participate? She said, maybe. I said, maybe is a yes. So we got her involved, and she was a participant after that.
And so you're working over at Woodhull Hospital, and you also
yes.
mentioned to me that you're at the senior centers around town?
Yes, I bring an arts experience to the seniors at a couple of centers, one in Washington Heights, one in Bushwick, and another one in Harlem. And these are seniors who are ranging in age from 70 to mid-90s.
And they're interested as well in taking on these art projects. Is it difficult for some of the elderly who may have some dementia or difficulty, say, with arthritis and
they're
mobilizing
some of
their
the
hands.
Best participants.
Yeah.
They are some of the best because I allow them to go at their own pace, and I give them something that they're able to do and able to complete, and so they have a feeling of accomplishment, they have a feeling of pride, and they keep coming back for more.
That's nice. You told me some funny stories about how sometimes they're sculpting men and women, and you tell them, is that a man or a woman sculpture? And they figure out how to get the anatomy on
well,
there, don't they?
They're literally like 70-year-old, 7-year-olds, and they're very mischievous. They can
cute.
Be pretty mischievous.
Yeah, I think art is a great outlet for people to express themselves when they sometimes can't. And I think for the elderly or for patients going through some tough times, I see this in the hospital where they have sometimes artists or art therapists or music therapists come in and they'll play a song or they'll do a quick painting, and better than giving an anti-anxiety medicine or a
exactly.
pain medicine, it takes that level down, like you said.
And then
you can't feel
thing,
the pain and happiness at the same time.
That's true. And then one thing I notice is that they prescribe Benadryl for the patients, and it usually makes them sleepy. And sometimes I have patients who refuse to go to sleep. They're, I'm going to push through this.
They're fighting the drug.
I'm not going to sleep. Exactly. Because they get so involved and they get so happy.
It's a really nice experience. How did you become an artist or an artist in this capacity? Did you go to school or is this a hobby?
I was a cancer patient myself, and I saw an advertisement for training for artists in residence, and I didn't think I would get the job, but I applied and I went through the training at the Creative Center, and then I got a call 2 weeks after the training was through that they had an opening. And I said, you really picked me? I didn't know I was going to be picked, or I thought there was a long waiting period, and it wasn't, it was immediate. So that was in 2011, and I've been there ever since.
And you mentioned that you were a patient at one point, and we talked before the show about your history with breast cancer, mm-hmm. and your diagnosis and the treatment and how fabulous you're doing now. Mm-hmm. Did they have this when you were undergoing your treatment?
I don't recall seeing anything like this. 25 years ago, that was way back, where a lot of the modern things that they have now available were not in place. So it's a wonderful thing to have available for the patients.
You kind of wish you had that available to you.
It would have been nice. As a matter of fact, though, when I went through another situation medically and I was back and forth at another hospital as a patient, they did have the artist in residence program, and I was asked by the artist, would you like to make this or that? And I said no. And then she came back around again, and she had to ask me three times, and it took me three times to say yes, because I really wanted to, but I didn't want to, but I didn't know how to say yes. And so that's another part of the issue, that they need to be welcomed and made to understand that this is for them and it's okay to say yes, but we don't disempower people. If they say no, then that's empowering for them, because if you think about it, the artist is the only person in the entire building that they can say no to. So the doctor say, well, take off your clothes, I'm going to examine you. They have to do it. The nurse, give me some blood. They have to do it. But would you like to make an art project? No. Okay, maybe tomorrow, maybe next time, or maybe next visit.
Well, that's nice. But some of my patients tell me no, so they run out the door. But, it's a great experience to be able to use it's a great experience you had as a patient that you've now brought the benefits of art mm-hmm. that you experienced back then. But getting back to more of being a patient, tell us a bit about what you went through 25 years ago and how you went about treating your cancer and fighting it both physically and emotionally.
Well, the negative side of it is that I was 37 years old and I had a lump on my breast that I had become aware of after a karate match, and I got hit in the chest.
After
and
a karate
course,
match.
Right. Now, of course,
you didn't
karate,
mention to that before
yeah.
the show that
well,
you
it's
were.
It's in my book. You were looking at my book.
I was.
But karate, does not cause cancer. Getting hit anywhere on the body does not cause cancer. But in my instance, I was very, very lucky that I got hit exactly where there was a problem, and it brought it to the surface.
Wow.
And I went to the doctor at age 37 to ask for an examination, and they told me, no, I didn't get a mammogram. I was too young. That I didn't fit any of the criteria for breast cancer. It's probably a cyst. Go home and put a warm compress on it.
But you knew something was wrong.
And I left crying because I was in a lot of pain, and that's not one of the criteria. At least it wasn't then. So that was my challenge, to get diagnosed. And I went to another center, and I told them what my symptoms were, and they diagnosed me. And it was already advanced, stage 2A, with 5 lymph nodes involved. So if I had just left it alone, it would have been a whole different story.
And you went through?
So then I went through, I chose to go through chemotherapy, radiation, and then follow up with tamoxifen for a number of years.
Wow.
And of course, there are many more options right now, and then there's the internet, but back then I had to go to the library, I had to call and ask for pamphlets to be sent to me, I had to do my homework, I went to 3 consultations, and then I made an informed decision, and I decided upon a lumpectomy with chemotherapy, radiation, high-dose chemotherapy, radiation, and hormonal therapy afterwards.
So you did your own research. You went to the library as opposed to today when people are just Googling on their phone. Do you think it's better today with all the extra information?
Much better, much better, because it was very time consuming and I didn't have time on my side. Mm-hmm. I was told by the first surgeon that I needed to get in the OR as soon as possible. But being the scholar and student that I am, I wanted to know what I was getting into. So I did my research first, and then I made a decision.
For many of our viewers, they don't understand that we had to go to the library back in the day to look this up and try to get information and make probably a ton of phone calls. And
exactly.
As opposed to today, from the phone, you could probably pull up the latest research.
Exactly
available.
Right.
You mentioned you were treated at Columbia Hospital in the city.
Back
Columbia
then
University.
It was called Columbia Presbyterian. I'm sure they've gone through a name change. But
there's been a lot of name changes in New York City with
exactly.
the hospitals lately.
Right.
And you had a positive experience there. You've been a survivor. You are a survivor.
Absolutely. I had great doctors. I had great treatment. I didn't have an artist in residence, but my experience going through the surgery and through chemotherapy and radiation was a positive one.
And so now you bring your experience as a cancer survivor, as an artist, and you bring that to the bedside at Woodhull as well as to the senior center.
Well, as an artist, yes. As a cancer survivor, no. I'm anonymous in that
right.
in that regard, because we don't want any comparisons. That's not part of the equation. I just come to them as Miss Happy. That's the name they gave me, Miss Happy.
Does it help you, though, having been a patient?
It does, because I can look at it from another perspective, and I know what they're going through. I know how they feel, so I know when to back off, and I know when to approach, and I know how they're feeling because I was there.
Yeah, I think until you are a patient, and there are many ways of being a patient, whether it's going for a surgery, undergoing cancer treatment, suffering from other diseases, until you've walked in the shoes of a patient, it's very hard to relate to the patients that we see as physicians and you see as an artist. And having been a patient, you've been a patient, I can tell you, it opens your eyes.
Absolutely.
To what they're going through.
And truly, they feel comfortable in sharing secrets with me sometimes, things that they wouldn't tell the doctor, things that they wouldn't tell the nurse. And sometimes I'm saddled with that, okay, what do I tell the nurse that I just discovered? Because I have a responsibility. Once they divulge something that might be injurious to their health, I have to pass that information along. So it gets a little bit tricky. So
but you're part of the care team, and that's very important.
Absolutely.
For us as physicians to have you and all the members of the team, I can tell you that when my patients in the hospital have someone playing guitar in front of them,
mm-hmm.
They definitely look like they tone down their pain level a bit. Their
Absolutely.
Anxiety seems to go down. And it is therapeutic. What about people like me who are terrible artists? I mean, I could barely do a stick figure,
There's no such thing as a terrible artist.
Do you have to guide certain patients with some extreme, extreme artistic help to get the
well,
project
there's
done?
There's no such thing. If they say, oh, well, I everything I make is ugly, I said, well, make me something ugly.
That I could do for you, yeah.
It's the matter of spending the time, being creative, and taking the mind away from what's going on in their cancer and in their medical situation. That's the whole idea of taking the mind away from that, the distraction.
Now I think our viewers need to know why you are such a personable person as well, and you probably are able to relate to many people, is that you were part of the flight crew for TWA for 27 years.
I was a flight attendant, yes.
Up in the friendly skies, you retired.
I think that's United's tagline.
Oh, sorry. you were TWA. I don't remember their tagline.
And up and away.
Was it really?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And then you, American Airlines took over.
Yes.
And you worked for American.
For a brief time.
And you were retired in?
2011, I think.
Not too long ago.
Not too long ago.
And you worked for 27 years. Do you think your experience in the stressful environment of this tube flying at 500 miles an hour at 40,000 feet helps you as well?
It helped me in terms of being able to understand people. When you're in that artificial environment, it's very easy to be very stressed out, afraid, nervous, and you got to think of why people fly. They fly for happy reasons, for sad reasons. They're going to a funeral or they're going to a graduation. So you sort of, you have all the extremes. So I learned how to deal with people because I'd be responsible for people, maybe 1,200 people a week, 1,200 different people a week. So you really, internationally,
it's
you get to know people.
Right.